The Gateway brings you the day's news from the St. Louis region and across Missouri. It also includes stories from the Illinois side of the river and our Metro East reporter, Will Bauer.
In Alton, in Belleville, in East St. Louis, in Edwardsville, in Cahokia Heights, at Scott Air Force Base, I'm Will Bauer, St. Louis Public Radio.
Listen to reports from Will and all of our journalists weekdays on The Gateway, on the STLPR app, and wherever you get podcasts.
Illinois has proven to be fertile ground for the Green Party, and there's no greater evidence of this than Illinois' 12th Congressional District, a place where candidates have done pretty well over the past few election cycles. Randy Auxier is hoping to continue that momentum, and he's part of a highly competitive race that's captured national attention. Auxier joins us next on the Politically Speaking podcast to talk about his beliefs and platform and how he stacks up with Republican Mike Bost and Democrat Brendan Kelly. Let's hit the music.
This is the Politically Speaking podcast, a candid conversation with the Show Me State's biggest political newsmakers.
I'm Jason Rosenbaum.
And I'm Joe Manish.
Elections should be about your accomplishments. What have you done to qualify you for the position, and why are you qualified to run?
I'm going to push back on these regulators.
I'm doing this for the people.
I was encouraged along the way, not just by my family, but by a lot of teachers and professors, and knew when I was in college that I would run for office someday.
We're very excited about the prospect of having some more free market solutions.
Even though after the conversation, I still might not agree.
We want our listeners to get a real sense of what drives these people.
They're actually people with a story to tell.
Thank you for listening to this podcast, brought to you by Lufu's Alfa Romeo, offering test drives of the Alfa Romeo Giulia, the 2018 Motor Trend Car of the Year at Lufu's Alfa Romeo in Fairview Heights.
And welcome to Politically Speaking. I'm your host, Jason Rosenbaum, a reporter with St. Louis Public Radio. I'm flying solo today, and we are thrilled to welcome our guest today,
Randy Auxier, and I'm a candidate for U.S. Congress in the 12th District in Illinois.
The Green Party candidate.
That is correct.
You are the first member of the Green Party we've ever had on this show. We interviewed a Libertarian candidate for St. Louis County Executive this cycle, but you are breaking new ground today.
So great.
And I'm glad that we're doing this because you drove all the way from Carbondale to come here.
Yeah.
Which I'm really happy about because I think that it's always better to talk in the studio rather than over the phone, but it is a sacrifice to drive 2 hours to get here. So
well, it's also not all that carbon wise, but I've been a DJ at WDBX down in Carbondale for 17 years and have done many, many interviews, and I know that they go better when you can look a person in the eye.
Oh my gosh, yes. So we're going to talk a little bit about how you play into this race, because I think everybody agrees you are a factor, which is the reason we're interviewing you. But we're not going to just spend 30 minutes saying, how are you going to factor into this race? We're also going to ask you about your positions on issues. But before we do that, tell us a little bit about yourself, what you do professionally, and kind of your history in the Illinois Green Party.
Sure. Well, I'm a professor of philosophy and communication studies at SIU Carbondale. Pretty much my entire adult life has been higher education. I did quit school for a couple of years and play bass in a rock and roll band.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, that was way back in the 80s.
Oh,
yes, I
do.
Yes, I do.
So who's your favorite bass player, by the way?
Well, the one that I most wish I could play like would have been Chris Squire of Yes, the late Chris Squire. I think he's the best bass player I ever heard, rock and roll bass player.
My favorite is John Entwistle.
Oh, okay. Well, he was fantastic, too.
Rest in peace to him as
Yes, as well. Yeah, I'm afraid the rock and roll life doesn't necessarily lead to longevity, but anyway, yeah. Esperanza Spalding has got to be the greatest bass player who's alive right now. And, of course, she can play anything.
Absolutely.
Yeah, yeah. So, anyway, that's my favorite bass player now.
So, from reading your bio, beyond just working at SIU Carbondale, you've been involved with Green Party politics in Jackson County since, like, 2000 or
that's
maybe
correct.
Even before.
Yeah. I moved to Illinois with my spouse in 2000, was very lucky to get that job in Carbondale. It was always my dream job. We came from Oklahoma, where we had been for 8 years prior
which
to
Which part
that?
Of Oklahoma?
Oklahoma City.
My great-grandmother and great-grandfather moved to Ponca City.
Oh, yes, I've been there.
in the 1920s and 30s, and my grandma grew up in Ponca City. So I am always thrilled to meet somebody who lived in Oklahoma.
Conoco. Conoco's in Ponca City.
Yes, it is. Yeah. And my great-grandfather owned a clothing store there, and he dressed all the Conoco executives. He went from being a penniless Polish immigrant to being able to buy lots of land because those Conoco executives needed nice clothes.
Yeah, that's great. Oklahoma was not it was not really suited for our temperaments. Both of us grew up in this valley. I'm from Memphis, and my spouse is from Clinton, Kentucky, which is just across the river, and we needed hills and trees. And so, and Oklahoma politics was pretty oppressive as well. And so that's one of the reddest of the red states. And there wasn't an organized Green Party there when we left. Otherwise, I would have joined the Green Party a lot sooner. But the instant we got to Illinois, we joined the Green Party. This was 2000.
And I want to talk a little bit about the Illinois Green Party because, you know, this is primarily a Missouri-based political show. And,
sure.
And the Green – let's be very honest. The Green Party in Missouri has not made a lot of headway over the last 15, 20 years. Sometimes they run in state legislative, congressional, or even statewide races. They get between 1% and 2% of the vote. Mm-hmm. Very different situation in Illinois. The high water mark was probably 2006 when Rich Whitney ran for governor. That was when Rod Blagojevich was running for re-election against Judy Bartopinka. He got 10.4% of the vote, which probably amounts to what? Has to be close to a million votes or something like that?
I would think it is close to that. Rich is my campaign committee chair. This go-round, he's also running for Jackson County Board. Rich got over 25% of the vote in Jackson County, where I come from, and the Greens are particularly strong there. But there are strong chapters of the Green Party throughout the state of Illinois. Generally speaking, apart from California and Maine, Illinois usually is about the third most important state Green Party organization. The National Green Party is a confederation of state Green Parties, and with regard to that that configuration, Illinois is quite influential.
And why is that? I mean, I'm from Illinois. Mm-hmm. I'm from suburban Chicago. Mm-hmm. It's not a super conservative state. Even the Republicans, like Bruce Rauner, I've always said this, Bruce Rauner runs for governor in Missouri. Because of his views on abortion and gun control, he gets 5% of the vote statewide.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, it does seem like there is a pretty activist streak that goes on not only in Chicago, but in more rural parts of Illinois. Explain why the Green Party is so strong here compared to other states.
Well, the only thing I can say is that so historically, Illinois has had corruption problems, and there are a lot more people who, as a result of the history of corruption in Illinois, have become disaffected, I think, with the two-party system. And it's not just the Greens. The Libertarians do well. Running for governor right now, we have a Christian conservative party in addition to a Libertarian candidate. There are a lot of folks in Illinois who don't trust the government, and I mean state government in particular. But so of the people, you know, who don't trust the government, some are quite conservative, some are quite liberal. And I think that that's fertile ground, if you'll forgive the forgive the metaphor, it's fertile ground for the Green Party as well as for other third-party efforts.
So let's talk about your platform, because I have covered this race in 12 and 14 when Paul Bradshaw was the Green Party nominee. She got between 5 and 6% of the vote.
Mm-hmm.
My understanding is, from watching that race, usually the Republican and Democratic nominees were not super liberal. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't classify Bill Enyard as a liberal.
No, he's quite conservative.
And Jason Plummer and Mike Bost, not even close to.
No, they're quite conservative.
Quite conservative. Yeah. Where do you fit into this race? Tell us a little bit about your political philosophy and your platform.
Okay. Well, I mean, I am ideologically about as green can get, in the sense that our 10 key values, including things like nonviolence and feminism, it's not all environment. Our 10 key values just simply describe perfectly what, you know, the views that I've come to over the years. I teach political philosophy. I teach political communication and persuasion. I know an awful lot about the history, not only of United States politics, but the history of politics as such, going back to the Western world. And I came to the views that I hold, which are just so much like the common sense views of the Green Party, as a result of a tremendous amount of thought and study. In the first presidential election that I voted in was 1980, and Carter was running against Reagan, and I voted for John Anderson. So perhaps I was on, you know, he got 2% of the vote. I was happy about that. He was a relatively conservative Republican, but Carter was an ineffective president, although a wonderful human being, and Reagan scared the bejesus out of me. And so, you know, what was I going to do? I wasn't going to not vote. But I'm 19 years old at that point, and I feel like I have to do something. And from that day forward, I've been uncomfortable with the two-party system. I just want more choices than that. Ranked choice voting would change this country for the better, and proportional representation even more. But that would require some kind of a constitutional change. But just ranked choice voting would make a huge difference because so many people would choose a Green Party.
Explain what that is, by the way.
Oh, it just means, you know, so you've got three or four candidates and you just – your first choice, your second choice, your third choice, and you just rank them. And so you get a certain amount of a percentage of credit, if you will, toward the office for being second choice and a percentage of credit for being third choice. There are lots of places – for instance, the state of Maine does this.
Yeah.
And so what that means is that, I mean, there are so many people whose second choice would be a Green Party candidate. And there are so many people who worry that if they don't vote for the Democrat or the Republican, they're throwing their vote away. Ranked choice voting is perfectly consistent not only with our electoral system, but also with our tradition in the sense that there have been, until the end of the Second World War, there were third parties all over the place. The GOP was a third party. It wasn't either grand or old at that point, and it wasn't a party either, because these were people, you know, Whigs and conservatives who were not comfortable with one another. But since the Second World War, the Democrats and Republicans really have gotten together to sort of clamp down on the presence of third parties. And so most of the people alive today don't have any memory of really active and really, the sort of challenge that a third party candidate would offer. William Jennings Bryan accepted the Populist Party's nomination and the Democratic Party's nomination in 1900. And so our electoral system used to just be a whole lot more open than it is now.
So Green Party, as you mentioned, is kind of associated with environment.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think it might be the name, but it also, when you look at a lot of the candidates, they mm-hmm. have really emphasized environmental
sure.
issues. Is that the case with you as well? And what would you want to do on a federal level that's different now? Obviously, you probably want to do a whole lot different than what President Donald Trump is doing.
Yes, yeah,
but be
yeah.
kind of specific on what you would like to see.
Well, I've been an environmentalist since the early 90s, about the time the Green Party came into existence. And the way that happened was just I became aware as a result of the music circles I was running in of the clear cutting and some things that were going on, and some buddies of mine went to Redwood Summer to try to prevent the clear cutting of the Redwood Forest at that time, and I sort of circulated for the next 4 or 5 years around the environmental activist movements. From that, I just learned so much about what's going on and how much things like money and corporate power end up affecting our political system. And the more I saw, the more unhappy about it I got. And then I began to become aware, especially after I moved to Illinois, that it's not just the environment that is being affected. It's everything in our entire democracy is being controlled by these same forces. It was a long, slow education in how it is that the workings of power are depriving ordinary folks, and I regard myself as one of those. I'm not a politician. I'm a teacher. But they're depriving ordinary folks of any serious voice in the way that things happen. And so I was an activist in the AAUP, the American Association of University Professors, in Oklahoma. When I got here, the SIU faculty I'm sitting in Missouri. When I got to Illinois, the SIU faculty was unionized. I instantly joined. This, to me, was a tremendous step in the direction of autonomy and shared governance for a university to have a faculty like that. And then I got active with the unions after that. I've been on the negotiating team for two collective bargaining agreements, and I helped lead a strike in 2011. And I have to say that that is a very empowering experience. Am I, you know, the union right or wrong. I don't think that unions are necessarily doing for ordinary folks all the things that they should do. And
yeah,
I have,
and that's a good segue to my next question. Both Kelly and Bost have said that they are pro-union for various reasons.
They have to in Illinois.
Yeah.
Well, I'm pro-union too, but there's a difference. I've been on strike.
Right.
I've negotiated collective bargaining agreements. I'm actually a part and an active part of a union. I don't think they really understand from the inside how unions work. Mm-hmm. And it's in Illinois, there's a tremendous history of, shall we say, cooperation between the unions and both political parties. Not so much the case in Missouri, but that goes very deep in Illinois politics, and it's a deeply ambiguous relationship, in my opinion. I do think that the public, the unions that represent public employees have been much stronger in recent years than any of the other unions, most of which have gone into decline in one way or another. But union politics can be pretty frustrating. There's a difference between what you might call the work of the union representing the members and negotiating contracts and union politics.
Well, Kelly, when he was on the show, really emphasized one of his reasons for getting in was kind of his disgust with how money and politics is going on. And I mean, we even talked about kind of the conundrum of people expressing that view and then being dependent on large amounts of outside money from political parties in order to be competitive. Cort Van Ostrand, who's running against Ann Wagner, is kind of going through that same situation where he's talking a lot about, I'm not going to take corporate PAC money, but in order for him to have in order for him to be, you know, really competitive against Ann Wagner, he needs that DCCC money, which has lots of corporate money in it. So what do you make of Kelly's emphasis on that, especially considering you brought up money in politics as one of your driving forces?
Oh, absolutely. Well, as you may be aware, the Green Party refuses all corporate donations. We don't accept that at all of any kind. And so if a PAC had corporate connections, we wouldn't accept the money. Brendan has, he's a sweetheart of a guy, but he has millions of dollars, corporate dollars, behind him, both what the DNC and what he has been able to raise himself for what you might call his campaign proper. And the PAC money is just unbelievable. Bost has even more. And so when Brendan says he wants to get the money out of politics, I believe that he's saying what he personally believes. I also believe that he thinks he doesn't have a chance to win without that money. And so he does take it. I mean, he's the Blue Dogs gave him money. He's really quite conservative on a number of issues. I think that his heart is expansive and that he's tolerant of disagreement, but personally quite conservative. And that's part of the reason they chose him is I think that they think the 12th District is such a conservative district that only two conservatives could run against each other. And that's basically what we've got.
One of the big issues that we talked with both candidates about was the tariff situation. And I don't want to say it's a weird issue for Illinois 12th, but it kind of is because I think that there are parts of the district, like in Granite City, that probably like it because the tariffs may end up long term, if they remain in place, driving more domestic steel production to like Granite City Works. It remains to be seen, but that's certainly the idea. On the other hand, you know, it's a very agricultural district.
You bet.
The retaliation from China has been pretty dramatic. What's your take on that? I don't really. I obviously know a lot about what the Green Party stands for with environment and corporate influence. I'd be interested to hear like what your take is on trade, because that's become such a big issue in American politics recently.
Yeah. Well, I would say that one of the President Trump put Mike Bost in a very difficult position with that, because under no circumstances can he come out against the tariff with Granite City. And actually, there's a lot of heavy manufacturing still in our district, especially along the river up here. And on the other hand, Bost is well aware that the retaliation can hurt the agriculture. And so he's you know, between the devil and the deep blue sea on that. I think that the protectionism argument goes way, way back. I do not believe that protecting heavy manufacturing is likely to work in terms of our long-term economic future. And I I think that if we can find a way to adapt the heavy manufacturing we have in this district and in this country to the things that are going to be built in the future, that it's quite possible to save it, in particular, rail transportation. They need steel for that. They need good steel. It's very expensive to ship that kind of steel from a place like China. If we would get on the ball and start manufacturing trains and train tracks and all of the infrastructure that is associated with the building of the rail system we're going to have in 50 years, we have to have it one way or the other. The fossil fuels, we're past peak oil. Everybody knows it. The fossil fuels are going to get more and more expensive. It is true that as, you know, petroleum technologies and drilling technologies improve, that we might be able to put off the year it's going to happen. But eventually it's not going to be affordable for an ordinary person to buy fossil fuels. And so alternatives have to be there. And I would say in Southern Illinois, getting mass transportation from St. Louis down to a place like Carbondale, just light rail, the kind of commuter rail you would get in, you know, the Long Island Railroad, something like that. We need that kind of infrastructure, not just in the 12th District, but all over the country. And if we were making those trains and if we were manufacturing the rails, they got to make them somewhere, and the 12th District of Illinois is an ideal place for that. We've got the shipping, we've got the manufacturing. They used to build trains in Southern Illinois, and now they just maintain them. But building trains is what we ought to be doing, from my point of view. And hydrogen trains would be even better than electric, and certainly not diesel trains anymore.
Yeah. What's your opinion on Donald Trump's foreign policy? Because one of the other things I'm well aware about the Green Party is during especially the Bush years, they were very much against military interventionism, mm-hmm. especially the Iraq War. Mm-hmm. They kind of had a weird alliance with like a lot of libertarians, where libertarians were against military interventionalism too. It's kind of difficult to even describe what Donald Trump's foreign policy philosophy is mm-hmm. right now, because it kind of goes all over the place. Mm-hmm. One minute he is talking about like bombing places like crazy. The next, he's like engaging in diplomacy with North Korea. So it's mm-hmm. I can't even really describe it. What's kind of your view on how the president is doing on that issue, given that he kind of fluctuates between being against military interventionism and then being loudly for it? I'd be interested in your view on that.
Well, sure. His foreign policy reminds me a good bit of Teddy Roosevelt's. In fact, he reminds me of Teddy Roosevelt in a lot of ways. He's the same kind of divisive character that Teddy Roosevelt was. And, of course, Roosevelt was bellicose and would beat his chest and try to, if he could, intimidate a foreign country of any kind into accepting a military base. And, you know, he sails his great white fleet around the world. And if you didn't want them to land, then, you know, maybe they're going to attack. That was and in the United States at that time, people were talking about the way they are now regarding our adventurous sort of appearance of the military. On the other hand, he didn't attack anybody. If you look at the pattern of our bombings, under Obama, we were bombing pretty much constantly, under Bush, certainly. Trump has actually, I don't think he likes paying for that. And he has actually cut back on the bombing. He's willing to do it.
Like in Syria,
for example. Yeah, for example.
And I'm sure that there's also situations in that ISIS zone where American planes have bombed places.
Sure. We're still bombing, but in terms of the rate of it, if you look at how expensive it is, you would begin to understand how somebody like Trump, as somebody who's never held public office but has run a lot of businesses, look at the bottom line and say, you know, it's going to cost us $8 million to send, you know, to send the B-52s just for this one sortie or something like that. And it costs about $8 billion to build a couple of B-2s. He loves the military equipment and he loves the military show, but it's not at all clear to me that he's the most bellicose in action of the presidents we've had. I think you probably have to go back to somebody like Carter to find somebody who's more reluctant to use the military. But That said, we don't know what he's going to do next. And I was listening to your station this morning, and they're interviewing the Chinese about representatives about the trade war, and they said we want to make peace on this trade conflict with the United States, but the trouble is their policy changes every day. And so we don't know where to start with fixing things. I guess that Trump keeps people off balance by being so incredibly inconsistent with what he says and what the rhetoric is and what he's willing to do. And so, you know, I'm just like everybody else. I don't know what he's going to do next.
What was your opinion on the tax cut bill? Because that probably is the major policy accomplishment that he's done so far. He clearly wanted to do something on the Affordable Care Act, and that hasn't gone anywhere. If the Democrats retake the House, I don't see any real headway on that issue.
No.
So, like, what do you think about the tax cut bill, which is, I think, going to be going into effect in full force over the next year or two?
Well, so mostly it's moving brackets, but the hidden sort of piece of the tax cut, I mean, my taxes went up as a result of the new, and a lot of people between 50 and 64 had their taxes go up, and that's my age bracket. That said, those people are actually the ones who vote. I mean, that's those and folks even older are the ones who vote, and so it looks like politically that was probably a bad idea. But the thing that's behind the scenes and that's going to cost our country trillions of dollars was the cut in the corporate tax rate, which I think is obscene. It essentially they're saying, I mean, Mike Bost would come to back to our district and point out that Walmart is giving its employees bonuses and I mean, but they won't give their employees a living wage. They won't give their employees full-time work if they have to pay benefits, et cetera, et cetera. But they'll hand them a one-time infusion that really comes from it doesn't come from the tax cut. It comes from anticipation of their costs going down. And that said, they're just saying thank you to the Republican senators and congressmen who essentially handed them billions and billions of dollars. Well, they haven't cut spending, so who's really paying for that? Our children and grandchildren, perhaps, if we ever pay off the national debt. But
yeah.
But anyway, so what do I think about it? I think it's obscene. I think that the corporate tax cut is obscene.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, one of the issues that was kind of percolating in Democratic politics, and especially Democratic primaries, is this Medicare for All proposal.
Mm-hmm.
Now,
sure.
I'm pretty sure Green Party candidates have always been for, you know, single-payer health care,
yep,
or for, you know, giving everybody either government-subsidized or government-run health care.
Mm-hmm.
What do you make of that debate, and what would be kind of your philosophical view on where you would want health care to go when it's talking about expanding government health care?
Well, if elected, I would sign on for House Resolution 676, which is the one you're talking about. There are a couple of other Medicare for All proposals out there, but 676 has about 50 Democrat co-sponsors. And I think in terms of just – well, so here's my philosophical bottom line. Our workforce needs to be healthier than it is. In order for us to be competitive with India, with China, we need, because there's 1.5 billion Chinese and there's 1.2 billion residents of India, there's only 350 million of us. We're a more productive workforce than they are, but we're not healthy. We would be more productive still if we were healthy. And in fact, at the lowest end, where we need the greatest productivity is where we're the least healthy. In addition to that, we're paying more and getting less than almost every other developed country in terms of our healthcare system. So with that said, you don't have to be some kind of bleeding heart to recognize that this is not competitive, it is not wise. And as China and India try to raise their standard of living for 1.5 billion people or 1.2 billion people, it's going to come at the cost of our standard of living in all likelihood, because they have so many more people that they can put to work. Now, their workers don't have to be as healthy as ours because they have three or four times as many as we have. And so just think of it in terms of the future of trade and ask whether it's in our interest to take care of the workforce. And I can't see any sound argument against what I just said. In our interest is to take care of our workforce. Now, how do we do that? Well, do we give a cut of that to the insurance companies? As long as insurance companies are making money off of people's ill health, we're essentially making our healthcare system a casino, where the insurer bets that I'm not going to get sick and I have to bet that I am. This is not how you handle healthcare wisely or responsibly. Furthermore, I happen to think healthcare is a human right. So add to the previous argument that now, yes, Green Party favors single payer, and so do I. I would vote for Medicare for All as a patch, but it doesn't begin to do what's in the interest of this nation economically. We are up against a wall trying to compete economically with China and India. And we have to take better care of our fewer people in order to be competitive.
So let's talk about the race, because I think, and I may be a homer here because I live like, you know, 2 miles away from the 12th congressional district. Mm-hmm. I think this is one of the A, most competitive congressional districts races in the country, and B, one of the most compelling. Mm-hmm. I think Bost and Kelly are very strong candidates.
Yeah, I think they are too.
They both have very extensive political resumes. You know, Bost, you know, has a long history of running in tough contests and pulling it out. And Kelly is a major political figure in the St. Louis area just by virtue of being St. Clair County state attorney. It's getting really nasty between the two. The ads have been very sharp. Mm-hmm. And I think that this could be a race that's decided by 1 or 2 percentage points either way. Obviously, if it's a Democratic mega wave, it could be different. The Green Party in the last 3 election cycles, when Paula Bradshaw was on the ballot, got between 5% and 6% of the vote. Mm-hmm. The candidates that won in those 3 years won by more than 5% or 6% of the vote. So they weren't really, quote unquote, spoilers here. Mm-hmm. But the fact that they're getting that large amount of votes means there's a constituency there.
You bet. And
you can't really just say, like, oh, these people are on the ballot to hurt someone like Kelly or Bill Enyer. There's actually people that support the Green Party.
So
how do you think you factor into this race? Because, I mean, if you win, obviously that's going to make international news.
You bet.
But I think that the feeling is you're going to get at least what Paula Bradshaw got or more, and that's going to be a factor in ultimate outcome. Where do you see yourself stacking up?
Well, about 19,000 people voted for Paula last time. The rise in raw numbers has been a sustainable rise every time we run. It's very difficult to become an established party in a congressional district in Illinois. Right at the moment, 12th District is the only one where the Green Party is currently established. We have been established in other districts in the past, but we have these prohibitive ballot access laws in Illinois. But that said, because of the ballot access laws, we can't skip a cycle. We have to push. We have to work. Obviously, we don't take ourselves to be either Democrats or Republicans. We're not ex-Democrats. I haven't ever really been a Democrat. And so when people talk to me about how I might be taking votes away from a Democrat, one of the things, they had a very powerful and I think wonderful candidate in the primaries, David Beckett, who the DNs, who his views and mine are hardly distinguishable from one another, but the DNC decided to bury him, and they did. I think probably they thought he couldn't win in this district, but they have conceded the entire left and most of the center, I would say possibly all of the center, and definitely the whole progressive vote in the district. They've just conceded that and assumed that those people will vote Democrat because they're afraid of the Republican. There are differences between Kelly and Bost, but the differences are slight compared to the differences between me and the other two of those candidates. And so the one thing that I think is, one, I have a chance to win. Here's the reason. Assuming that 19,000 folks continues to vote green, which I believe they will, they have certainly shown a willingness to. About 210,000 people vote in a typical congressional election in this district. That means I need 75,000 votes to win.
It's a pretty big jump, though.
55,000 votes on this particular election cycle strikes me as doable. Mm-hmm. There are several reasons. One is that young people who didn't turn out since Obama ran. They stayed home last time, and we still increased our numbers. I do not think that either Kelly or Bost appeals to young people at all, and I think that I do. And so getting the message to them is, of course, my first concern. African-American voters have no reason at all to support either one of those candidates. And I have a strong civil rights background and activism in those areas. I believe that if the progressives turn out and if young people turn out, that I can actually put on the 55,000 necessary for me to win. So under no circumstances do I concede that I can't win this race. Mm-hmm. So with that said, I'm not I think that the spoiler arguments almost always depend on the following false assumption. First of all, historically, we've hardly ever been even accusable of spoiling. The Nader thing is something every Green Party
person. But in this race, have not been a spoiler, just because the margins have been over 5% and 6%.
Yeah, not in this district and not historically. But here's the thing. There's always the assumption that somehow the people who would vote, who vote Green, would vote for the Democrat. And I don't think it's true. I think that they split about, in fact, the research shows that they split about 50-50.
Well, it's interesting you mentioned that. The aforementioned Democratic Congressional Campaign Committee put out a poll in this race where they included you and they excluded you. When they included you, you got about, I think, 7 or 8% of the vote, and Bost was up by 1. When they excluded you, which really, you should not poll this district without the Green Party candidate.
No, huh? Because we're here.
That's kind of silly.
Yeah.
Bost is up by 2. And that,
so Bost is up by 2 without me.
Without you.
Mm-hmm. Which, that doesn't surprise me at all, because I know the spoiler argument is just fear. And I understand why people are afraid that their person might lose. But the assumption that Green Party folks would vote for Democrats if they weren't voting Green, there's no evidence for it.
My only other question is, what effect do you think the Illinois governor's race is going to have on a contest like this? Because, and I guess I can say this openly because I don't cover Illinois politics, Rauner looks like he is going to lose by a lot to Pritzker at this point.
Yeah, I think
things could change. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying Pritzker is running in a perfect campaign, but Rauner has alienated Democrats and a lot of socially conservative Republicans. Mm-hmm. How do you think that affects the turnout and the outcome in this contest? I know it's a federal race, but, you know, if the person at the top of the ticket goes down in a double-digit defeat, it's probably not helpful for Bost. But I could also see the fact that Trump is not super unpopular in this district kind of evening that factor out. I'd be interested to hear your take on that.
Well, so I don't think Trump is popular in the district at all. And I think that especially as we move into the closing weeks of the campaign, that Bost will probably seek to put some distance between himself and Trump. Remember that it's true that Trump got 55-56% of the vote in the 12th district. On the other hand, Tammy Duckworth carried the district, and she's quite a liberal Democrat. And that said, I think that people were voting against Hillary. And so an awful lot of Democrats voted for Trump, and a lot of folks who simply couldn't bring themselves to
vote for Mark Kirk.
Exactly. And so,
well, Kirk had a lot of problems. Yeah. Like, he made some, and he's my former congressman, and I feel for him because of what happened with his stroke. He made a lot of very off-putting statements during that campaign. And he's kind of suffering from the same problem Rauner has, where Kirk is not a very conservative Republican.
Right.
So conservative Republican voters are not super excited about him. And it was just not going to happen for him.
Well, the 12th district is amazingly diverse.
Yeah.
It shouldn't be a district, I have to be honest with you. I think that the trouble is that we were talking earlier about the steel and the agriculture sides of the district, and it puts Mike Bost in a no-win situation with regard to the tariff, because, you know, if he speaks out against it, then the industrial part is...
You can blame the Illinois Democrats for drawing that district. Well,
yeah, I know. And to me, it's really, really strange that they would have drawn it the way they did. I suppose that they were betting that they could retain the seat that was lost by Inyart, that they could retain the seat and neutralize a number of quite red counties at the same time. And it didn't work.
It backfired.
Yes.
It just shows that sometimes gerrymandering doesn't work out. Well, thank you so much for coming to do the show here.
Sure.
For all of our stories, stlpublicradio.org. Follow me on Twitter, Jay Rosenbaum. How could people find out more about your campaign, either on social media or your website?
Sure. RandyForCongress.org is the campaign website. And all you got to do is type in my name, Randy Auxier, or Randall Auxier, and it'll take you to our Facebook page and our other social media and Twitter. I think it's Randy for So Ill is my Twitter.
So
account.
Ill.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's funny how that works out. Until next time, so long.
Here we go. Here we go, one more time. Everybody's feeling fine. Here we go now.
Yes, here we go. We're thinking's got the flow.
Put your head to the beat. We got everything you need. Here we go now.
Yes, here we go. We're thinking's got the flow.
Here we go, just one more time. And everybody's feeling fine. Here we go now.
Here we go, yeah.
If you wanna party with us, just go free and feel the rhythm.
Sponsored by Lou Fuse Alfa Romeo of Metro East.
If you have a smart speaker, you have access to the entire world of NPR and St. Louis Public Radio. All the latest news and all the captivating stories. Activate our voices with yours by telling your smart speaker to play St. Louis Public Radio.